I have in my hand here, I know you can't see it from the back, but I have in my hand here a 1985 quarter. You know what a quarter looks like. In the center is the etching of George Washington's portrait. The word Liberty is printed on the top of it. On the right is the letter D. It was minted in Denver. And on the bottom is a date. And on the left are the words, "In God we trust." Those words, "In God we trust," they weren't always printed on our currency. The first time they appeared was towards the end of the Civil War in 1864. They were put on a 2-cent piece. And it wasn't until 1957 that they started to appear on all United States currency. There are always some who objected to putting it on the currency, not because it was a church and state issue, as we might think in this secular age today, but rather they thought putting those words on a coin was a sacrilege, putting God's name on that symbol of worldly power and wealth, on that symbol of mammon. There were people in Jesus' time, too, who felt the same way. The coin that was used to pay the census tax was a Roman coin. A Roman coin had the image of the emperor Tiberius Caesar on the front, and on the back was an etching of the goddess Roma. And the inscription on the coin said, "Pontifex Maximus," translated as "the Most High Priest." To the Pharisees, this was blasphemy. To them, it was like an affirmation of the divinity of the emperor, and a validation of pagan worship, and they wanted nothing to do with it. Now the Herodians, on the other hand, had no problem with Roman coins. They were more than willing to cooperate with the Roman masters. They found that there was much more prosperity and much more peace in cooperation than in resistance. It would have been a curious thing to see these Pharisees and Herodians side by side. For they were not friends. They were more likely to be seen avoiding each other. But on this one occasion, they were able to join forces to try to trap Jesus into choosing one side or the other. "Render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's." And the next words in the gospel read, "And hearing this, they were amazed, and leaving him, they went away." They were confused. Jesus didn't come out on the side of the Pharisees. He more or less said, "Pay the tax." But he really didn't come out on the side of the Herodians either, for he reminded them that their first loyalty belongs to God. I think sometimes we have a tendency to say to ourselves, "Oh, good for Jesus. He put those hypocrites in their place." But I don't think that was what really Jesus intended to do. Rather, it was to challenge them, for each of them, to challenge them for each of them to look into their hearts and really think about where their loyalties lie. I call it a call to conscience. When we hear these words proclaimed this morning, these words are a call to conscience for each one of us as well. We in this country have been truly blessed and greatly blessed with the liberties and freedoms our government has provided for us. And we have a civil duty to nurture, to protect, and yes, even to defend these gifts that we've been given. But we are also citizens of another kingdom, the kingdom of God. This kingdom, it doesn't negate our duties to our worldly home. Rather, I would say it transcends them. It's not a kingdom that's limited by boundaries and borders. It's not a kingdom measured by wealth and power. It's a kingdom that reaches out to all people, whether native or foreign, man or woman, black or white, Christian or non-Christian. It's a kingdom whose focus is on the welfare and the benefit of others rather than on its own. It's a kingdom that reaches out to all. One of my teachers once told me that it's not a good idea to mix politics and religion in my homilies, and I'm sure that's good advice. But it's also true that we can't separate our religion from our daily lives, even when our daily life is touched by the politics and affairs of this world. Just as our citizenship in this country carries with it duties and responsibilities, so does our citizenship in the kingdom of heaven. We have the duty to respect all life that God has created, from the moment of conception to the moment of death. We have the duty to use the resources and the talents that we have been given for the benefit of all. We have a duty to care for the poor, the stranger, the injured, regardless of their race or their origin. And we have the duty to come together as a community to give the Lord glory and honor, as we sang in the psalm today, to give thanks and praise to our Creator for all the wonderful gifts He has given us, especially for the gift of His love. And just as being a good citizen of this country means more than reciting the Pledge of Allegiance, so does being a good citizen in the Kingdom of Heaven involve more than professing our beliefs. We need to act out these beliefs. It should be evident that we are citizens of the Kingdom of Heaven by the things that we say to others and the things that we do in our daily, everyday lives. We should carry our Christian ID cards of compassion and forgiveness with us in all our dealings with this world. Because in truth, we all sometimes fall victim to the allures of power and prestige that this world offers us. And we too need the compassion and the mercy of God to enter one day into full citizenship into that Kingdom of Heaven. You know, the people that first put those words on this coin, "In God we trust," they showed a lot of wisdom. It reminds us that even though we may need a lot of this quarters, a lot of this money, to be successful in this earthly world, to be successful in our heavenly world, it's in God we trust.